Welcome to r/RedditRevenge. This is a story of someone getting back at someone with revenge after being wronged. Thank you, friends, for subscribing to the channel and for so many likes. The first story, entitled Neighbor Threatened My Dogs and Family. The second story, the buyer wanted to cheat on me after buying a car. The third story, a surgeon frequently speaks out against a life-saving medical procedure. And the first story is, entitled Neighbor Threatened Dogs and I Break. Years ago, my mother and I had just moved to a new dog-friendly apartment complex. We had two dogs. One was a Bichon Shih Tzu, and the other is a Terrier-Poodle mix. Because of them, we were excited for the community dog park right next to our building. Also to note, our whole building was filled with dog owners, each with dogs ranging from small to huge. Our apartment was on the first floor in the back of the building, all the way in the corner. It was a nice private area for us, with how the apartments were situated. Since one of our dogs is a terrier, he can be a bit barky when we're not home. Though when we are home, we have a clicker to get his attention, which he has been trained to stop barking and come to whoever has the clicker. Due to our work hours, I was usually home in the morning, and Mom was home in the afternoon, leaving him alone for a few hours during the day. After a month of moving to our new apartment, we received a note on our door. It was from one of our neighbors. It stated, "Dear neighbor, I understand that you're new to this complex, but it's rude to allow your dog to bark. It's ruining my sleep before I go to work, and my job is extremely important. I don't care how you do it, but shut your dog up." My mom turned in the note right away to the leasing office, as she wasn't sure what to do with it. That's when the office told us to not worry, because he had done this to every dog owner in the building. They did ask us to see if we can find ways to calm him down when we were not home. So, we did. We found out the kids of the neighborhood like playing with the power station outside our apartment, and that's who he had been barking at. So we closed off that area for him when we went out, and no one was home. We started playing calming music as a way to help as well. Another week goes by, and this time we hear a knock at the door. We go outside, and we meet our angry neighbor. He explains that our dog has kept him up every day and woke him up with his hours of barking. Both of us had been home that day, and our dog had been a good boy and had not had excessive barking. I still remember what he had told us when I explained that. "I know what I heard. If you can't control your dog, then I'm going to call animal control and have them both taken from you. I did it before and have no problem getting rid of your dogs too. Then I'll get you kicked out for not following your lease, and I can do that because I'm very rich, and the apartment needs my money. So do something to shut your dogs up or else." After that and my mom apologizing for what had happened, we went back in. A few months later, I walked out to get the mail, and discovered from another neighbor that he had gone to three other apartments and made similar threats. After some convincing, my mom told the apartment what had happened. We were told not to worry, and if he did that again, to please contact them. We also found out that the apartment had offered him an apartment away from the dogs. But he had declined since the dogs were the problem and not him. However, what he had done, my mom began to show signs of anxiety and bought a lemon spray bark collar for our dog. While I didn't like this idea, it had put her at ease to go outside our apartment. We did make sure to only put it on him when we were both not home. A month went by peacefully, then once again we got a knock on our door. This time it was animal control. They had gotten an anonymous report of a dog being abused and neglected in our home. They explained that someone had said that our dogs were barking because of neglect. My mom invited the AC lady inside and explained the situation. We showed her everything we could to prevent our dogs from being taken away. The nice lady noticed how playful and happy our dogs were and figured it was another false call. She explained that they had gotten a few of those from an anonymous concerned neighbor for other apartments in this building. The AC lady left, telling us that if they're threatened again, to try and get it on record. This event had turned my mom into a paranoid person who became afraid to leave the house, thinking that if she did, then she would lose her pups. Normally, I'm the calmest person in my family, never really letting anyone get to me, but this neighbor had did this to hurt us. So I did my research and discovered a few things that could legally help us. With new information on certain laws and leasing terms, I formed a plan. During a weekend that my mom was visiting my aunt in a different state, I began my plan. I started it by printing out a few things, and then sat outside with my phone and a speaker. I began to play a video of a dog barking really loud. I had figured out which apartment was his, thanks to a few neighbors who also were tired of being harassed. I sat there looking across the courtyard to where his apartment was. I waited with a huge smile on my face, and as I hoped for, he stormed out and headed over to where I was. I turned off my video and turned on my recorder without him noticing. His face is red with anger as he looks at me sitting there with a smile. "I'm sorry, can I help you?" I ask him. "F you, I effing told you what I'll do to your family if you effing didn't stop your dumb A mutt from ruining my sleep. Now I'm going to get them taken from you and get you kicked out for not doing as I said. I gave you an effing chance. I hope they take your dogs and you and your mom live inside a cardboard box." I give him a fake "oh dear" look and say, "So are you saying that I'm not allowed to make loud noises, including my dogs barking, between the hours of 7 a.m. and 11 p.m.? and that I went against the law by doing so? You know you did. And you're telling me this from my porch at 2 p.m. in the afternoon? This won't be your porch once I tell the leasing office. Oh no, that's a very serious threat for my dogs and my family, isn't it? F yes it is. I give him a huge smile and turn off my recorder for my phone. The neighbor's confused now, and I ask him to have a seat. I have a few things to show him. I pull out my papers and hand him the first one. It was the county's noise ordinance laws. In our county, a dog's bark was considered the same amount of sound as a loud appliance, so they can bark between the hours of 7 a.m. and 11 p.m. Before he could talk, I pulled out another paper. This one states that it's against the leasing terms to threaten another neighbor, and after one warning that the apartment complex had the right to revoke their lease. He looks at me with an understanding of what he had done now. I silence him and pull out one last paper. This one was another leasing term I had found. This face after reading this one had made him turn white. This last one talked about how it was a complete violation of leasing terms to go onto another renter's property and threaten them or their property. This includes the renter's outdoor area. Those found guilty of this violation will have their lease revoked immediately and be forced to leave the apartment within a set time. The scared look on his face was priceless as I silently got up and walked back into my apartment. After he finally left, I called my leasing office and explained what had just happened and agreed to email the recording to them right away. A week later, my mom came home with some news that she had learned from the leasing office. The man had been evicted from his apartment and would be leaving later that week. I found out that my actions had caused the other dog owners of the building to come forward and admit what he had been doing to all of them. After that, there was never another complaint, and I threw away the lemon spray dog collar. As for me, I don't regret what I did. I just feel bad that it had to come to this. The next story is, the traffic tickets became the least of his problems. A few years back, my old car was on its last legs. My mechanic said it wouldn't last much longer, and the best thing to do was sell it cheap and move on before it gave out and was ready to be scrapped. I love that little car, but I put it up on Craigslist for $500 and got a bite. The guy buying it was in his 20s with a pregnant wife, and his dad was footing the bill. I was clear with them that it was sold as is, and I couldn't make any promises about its longevity. The buyer said that if it lasted 6 months, he'd be happy with the purchase, so he signed the bill of sale and I handed over the title. I immediately went to the DMV website and registered it as a sale, and assumed he would finish the process by transferring the title. Turns out I was wrong about two things. The car lasted much longer than 6 months, and he didn't bother to pay the $77 to transfer the title. I discovered this when I received a photo radar ticket for running a red light. I was confused because the street was way across town, in an area I rarely visit. When I went online to view the high-res traffic cam photos, I found it was the buyer in my old car, but my name was still attached to the plates. After some serious cursing, I copied all the records, dates, bill of sale, etc., and mailed copies off to the courthouse. It was his citation, but I had to prove it to the court. 2 weeks later, I got another letter from the fuzz. Another ticket, this time for speeding, same driver, same car, same plates, with my name still attached. Again, I had to copy all the paperwork, write a long letter to the clerk, and mail it all off to the courthouse. The third ticket really made me mad. I started making calls and discovered that this scam is pretty common. Some folks buy a junker and rack up fines until they wreck or abandon the car, and their name was never on it, so nobody bothers to punish them for it. It's all on the previous owner to clean up the mess and prove who is at fault. This time, I wrote an extra long letter to the court clerk and did a little research to include the guy's picture, home address, and listed phone number. A few months went by and I thought it was over. Heck, the car should have given out by now anyway. Then the fourth ticket arrived, showing him in high res, zipping past a radar cam in my old car, with my old bumper sticker still on the back, Giant Meteor 2016, and all his kids piled into the back seat. The fifth and sixth tickets felt like Groundhog's Day. I didn't even bother to put the paperwork away. I kept it out on my desk ready to copy. By the time the seventh ticket arrived, we were well over a year beyond the sale. And enough was enough. This wasn't just some dude forgetting to do some paperwork or not knowing the right way to go about buying a car. This was intentional. It was time for some pro revenge. First, I called the police, and after a week of back and forth, finally spoke with a traffic cop who said enough is enough and went to pay the guy a visit. He said he couldn't disclose what would happen during that discussion, but the total amount of the likely unpaid traffic tickets was enough to get his attention. The tickets and late fees were several times the value of the car. That wasn't enough. Just having to pay his tickets wasn't appropriate for the seven freaking times I had to copy that D-bill of sale for the court clerk. So I started going back through my records of every ticket and every photo, and I found an interesting theme. In every photo, his tiny kids were in the car, including the newborn infant, all packed into the back seat. I called Child Protective Services anonymously. I didn't provide any information that was not 100% factual and verifiable. The tickets showed that this guy was operating an identity fraud scheme out of his home, essentially stealing my identity and who knows how many others. His children were present throughout. Furthermore, he regularly violated traffic rules and put his children in serious danger by speeding, running red lights, and committing other traffic violations. If he was doing this stuff so often in front of a big white camera, how do you think he was driving when he wasn't being watched? I declined to provide my name or number, as I had nothing more to offer and didn't want to be involved in the case any further. I gave them all the evidence I had of three small children in repeated dangerous and illegal situations, all of which were verifiable by photo evidence and court documents. After that, I stopped getting traffic tickets from him. Maybe the car finally gave out. The last story is, won't tell your patients about all their options? We'll educate them when you won't. I work for a medical device company that developed a groundbreaking alternative to a very risky surgery. This technology makes it possible to treat the issue through a minimally invasive surgical procedure that takes 1 to 2 weeks of post-operative hospital stay down to 1 to 2 days. We have performed some of the most robust and extensive clinical trials and post-market surveillance in the industry to prove just how effective this procedure and our devices are, and by most metrics there are better patient outcomes with our procedure than with the typical surgical route. Well, some surgeons really don't like us encroaching on their turf and refuse to accept that this is a better option than surgery for some patients. There's one surgeon in particular who's very outspoken against us and continuously presents erroneous data about the procedure. He also will not tell his patients that there's an alternative to the very risky surgery, even when they're super old and sick and may not survive the surgery. The company I work for thinks this is unacceptable and completely immoral, so they bought out all the ad space on this surgeon's page on a website that's essentially Yelp for doctors and have things like "Scared about X surgery? There's a minimally invasive alternative. Ask your doctor if it's right for you." All over his page in at least 5 places. He doesn't own the page and can do literally nothing about the ads we place there. So now whenever potential patients look him up, they get bombarded with information about the very procedure he refuses to tell them about.
Thank you for watching. Bye.